Reckoning has nothing to do with feelings. And Paul is saying, you might not have felt it, but this is the reality you've got to believe, count on, stand on, and have a settled confidence in. Now let's put this to practice. Let's see how the rubber meets the road. Suppose you are a new Christian and you have particular weaknesses, you have particular sins that you are grappling with. For example, you're grappling with pornography. You go to a computer, certain websites come up, certain images come up, and you say, wow, this is too tempting. The urge is too strong. I don't think I can overcome this problem. And I think it's okay to indulge for a while. After all, I don't think I'm able to overcome these strong urges. You felt like committing or indulging in that sin, but that's where reckoning needs to come in. It felt so strong, but that's where you need to tell yourself, based on God's word, that I am dead to sin. I'm no more under its bondage. I need not succumb to it. Maybe there's someone who has really irritated you in your life, maybe your neighbor, and you feel so bitter against that person. And you say, even if you become ashes, I will remember you. The Chinese have a saying, 你化成灰我都会记得你. And you told yourself, I'll never be able to forgive him or her. I'll never be able to. You know something? That is saying, I have not reckoned myself to be dead to sin and alive unto Christ. In effect, that's what happens when we say we have no choice but to sin. No, you have been set free and you've got to reckon it to be true. Deep down in our hearts, deep down in the inner man, we've got to say, we've got to believe, we've got to count on the reality that I'm dead to sin and alive to Christ. Not just the theoretical knowledge, but a belief in the heart. I like, again, to show you what John MacArthur said last week, I shared with you. Until a believer accepts the truth that Christ has broken the power of sin over his life, he cannot live victoriously, because in his innermost being, he does not think it is possible. Problem? He does not reckon it to be true for his life. John Owens, again, he said, one of the hardest things is to convince Christians that they are freed from the bondage and slavery of sin. You're set free. This is an amazing thought, isn't it? That we are to reckon ourselves to be dead indeed unto sin. You know something about Romans? We have been going through the book of Romans 5.5 chapters. We began this journey in February this year. For 5.5 chapters, do you realize that Paul has not given a command to anyone? Do you realize that? Paul has not given an imperative. That's the Greek, in a sense, a command to anyone. The very first imperative that occurs in the book of Romans is right here, Romans 6 verse 11. Reckon. It is written in an imperative voice. In other words, this is what is commanded of you to do. You are to reckon. What I learned is this. Before we try to do things for God, we've got to start with recognizing what God has already done. For 5 chapters, he's telling you what God has done. And then he says, this is the response I want you to have. Reckon. Believe. Know that this is what I have done for you. What is it that gives you victory over sins and about over the world and over the trials and afflictions of life? What is it that keeps you in victory? 1 John 5 tells us, even this is the victory. It is our faith. Faith, believing. See, this is a key word, reckoning, believing. Faith that overcomes the world. Why? Because you're believing in what God has already done. Christians, friends, so many of us are believing in trying. Everyone tells you, you've got to try harder. try. And we forget Christian living is first trust. It's not about you crucifying yourself. It's about you knowing you are already crucified. It's not about what you will do, but what Christ has already done. Keep on reckoning, he says. This is the tense of verse 11. Keep on reckoning. So there will be new temptations, new situations that arise in your life. You've got to keep on reckoning it to be true. Auntie has to keep on reckoning that all the angku kuih is going to choke up her blood vessels. And even though she keeps herself in check today, she is still to reckon it to be true tomorrow. Christian living is a moment by moment process of knowing and also reckoning. Keyword. And may the Lord help you to have firm, settled confidence in this declaration of God, that you are dead unto sin, but alive unto God. By the way, this is not positive thinking. Some of you may think, "Wow, Pastor, you're teaching us positive thinking. Think positive things, you'll be fine." No, this is not positive thinking. The world teaches positive thinking. In fact, there's something called the word of faith that has crept into churches. They think that what word of faith essentially is this. If you confess and believe something, it will come true. So, for example, I'm sick, and you confess, "God, I am healed," but you're still coughing away. "But God, I'm healed," then you're coughing away still. "But God, I am healed," but 3 days later, you're still coughing. But the word of faith propagators say, the more you say it, the more you confess, the more you'll come true. Now, I think that is absolute rubbish. That is positive thinking from the world brought into the church, confused into the church. And Paul is not teaching positive thinking. Paul is teaching positional thinking. There's a difference. Positive thinking is wishful thinking. But positional thinking is biblical thinking. What God has already said, you stand upon His word and reckon it to be true. So, sanctification begins not so much with what we will do, but it begins with what God has done. Know it. He has crucified your old man, given you a new life. And reckon it. When you meet with temptations, you don't have to give in to those temptations. You can know and reckon that you are freed from the bondage of sin and God has given you a new life. Keep on reckoning. But finally, there's a third word you need to grasp, and it is the word to yield. The word yield is made up of two words in the Greek. It's a compound word. And it means to place beside. So when I yield something, it means I take what I have and place it beside you for your use. Place beside. To give over. That's the word yield. And Paul here tells you what you are to yield and who you are to yield to. It says in verse 13, "Neither yield ye your members." That's a reference to the body. The body. "Neither yield ye your members as instruments." Really, the word in the Greek should be better translated as weapons. Strong word. Don't yield your body as weapons. Wow, it's the different light altogether, isn't it? And you can yield your body as weapons to two masters for two different purposes. One master is sin, and sin will use your body as a weapon of unrighteousness. You can yield your body to God, and God will use your body as a weapon of righteousness. So you have a choice. You see, what Jesus had done is that He has broken the dominion and the authority and the slavery of sin. But it doesn't mean you will never sin, because you still have a choice. He has broken the authority, but He has not taken over, in a sense, your will. You still have a choice. You have a choice to yield your body over to sin so that it can be a weapon of evil, or you can yield your body over to God as a weapon of righteousness. There's a choice for you. I learned something about the body. The body is neutral. You can't say the body is evil or good. It depends on who you yield it to. That's why over here he says it can be yielded as righteousness. In Romans 12:1, he says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. Your body, a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God. So the body is neutral. The problem or the danger is that we might yield it to sin. And so Paul warns us. He says, be careful, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. Yes, Jesus has set you free from the bondage, but you can still foolishly re-surrender yourself and yield yourself to sin's control. You can. I today can still do jumping jacks for Sergeant Yong if he comes into my life. I can choose to do that. I need not do that, but I can choose to do that. And that will be foolish. There's a story told about two princes, Reynold and Edward. And they were fighting for the throne of the kingdom. Well, Reynold was an unusual man. He was particularly greedy and he was obese, really fat. And Edward eventually won over Reynold. And what Edward did, so as not to be seen as a cruel man to his subject, say, all right, I will not kill Reynold. What I'll do to Reynold is I will build for him a castle. And he'll stay in a room of the castle. And he's free to walk in and out of the castle. He's free to do so. But the only condition is that he must go through the door. Now, the door is a normal size door. But to Reynold, it's not big enough. And so he puts Reynold into this room where there's a normal size door and says to Reynold, you can go out. And when you go out by yourself through this door, you're free. But Reynold tries his best. He's so obese, he tries, he squeezes all kinds of directions. He claws on the floor, he goes to the side, but he could not get out through the door. So how can he get out of the door? Lose weight lah. Either get a plastic surgeon of our day to go there, or he lose weight by eating less. But his brother, Edward, knows how to get him. Every day, Edward sends the best delicacies of the land to Reynold. And Reynold sees all the food, he could not resist himself, and he feeds and stuffs himself with all kinds of delicacy. And instead of trimming down, he got bigger and bigger and bigger, and he was trapped in that room for all his life. Now everyone will say, hey Edward, how could you do this? Edward says, no, I never imprisoned him. He could walk out free. It's Reynold who trapped himself. Jesus has set us free from the bondage of sin. But you know what? We can still indulge in our appetites, sinful appetites, and trap ourselves in sin. Let not sin reign, therefore, in your mortal bodies. Now, you say, how, Pastor, can I choose to do right? Because I've tried it many times. I've tried to live a good Christian life, and I know I should not yield myself to sin. I should yield myself to God, but I fail over and over again. Why? Well, let's look at this verse. He says, don't yield yourselves as members or your members as instruments or weapons of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God. There's something I think is so precious. Holy living is not simply saying no to sin. You know how often it is? When a sin comes, a temptation comes, we say no, 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 no. And we respond to it immediately by our saying no to it. And then you realize soon after you fall back into that sin. Because I think true victory comes with not just saying no to sin, but saying yes to God.